الحمد لله رب العالمين، الحمد لله ذي الملك والملكوت، ذي العزة والجبروت، الحمد لله ذي الفضل والكرم، ذي القدرة والنعم، الحمد لله حي قيوم لا ينام، عزيز لا يضام، قهار لا يرام، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما. يقول الباري سبحانه وتعالى بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. Or you believe, fear Allah as he should be feared, and dare not except on the state of Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful, grant us this great gift to die on the state of Islam. Allahumma ameen, ya arhamar rahimeen. Amma ba'd. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, praising his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and starting by saying, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the greatest, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator, he's sending his blessing, he's making salah, which is mean from Allah, the sending of the divine blessing on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and also do the angels. And he made a command for the believer to do so, to send there and ask, pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower with his divine blessing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and to salute him with all respect. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this ayah mentioned in Surah Al-Ahzab. And in Surah Al-Ahzab, it is an image of the greatness of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the greatness of his striving. And in the beginning of the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala announcing to all the believers that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is closer to us than we are to ourselves. Allah, as he said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, النَّبِيُّ أَوْلَى بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ مِنْ أَنْفُسِهِمْ وَأَزْوَاجُهُ أُمَّهَاتُهُمْ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is closer to us than ourselves, than we are closer to ourselves. And his wives are the mothers of the believer. They are our mothers. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is not the father of anyone. He is the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So his status is a very special status. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shown us in Surah Al-Ahzab, the great leader, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, leading the companion of the one Allah ta'ala alayhim in this facing the greatest of the army they ever faced in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is the Confederate army. And then show us the image of the great leader in his family with his wives and the way how he's dealing with them sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then show us as a great dealer, as a great leader in implementing the ahkam of Allah when the hukum is very hard. When Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he has to have come to a dissolution of his marriage with Zayd ibn Jahsh. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be the example for the believer that is permissible, because in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tradition, it was forbidden somehow for someone to marry the one that al-waliyu, which is an adoptive son, they call it adoptive son, but you know it's forbidden in Islam. But for Zayd, it was very difficult for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who lived with him like a son. He will marry his wife that he divorced, and after he divorced, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked to do such a thing to be an example for the believer. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defending his Prophet, قَالَ مَا كَانَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ مِنْ حَرَجٍ. But it was very difficult in a way that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam cannot even disclose it. He was hiding it in himself. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was reproaching the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, قَالَ تَخْشَى النَّاسِ. والله سبحانه وتعالى أحق أن تخشاه. And all of this, all what you're seeing in Surah Al-Ahzab is a tiny image of the greatness of the striving of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then is this all striving, it being crowning toward the end of Surah Al-Ahzab for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to glorify and to show the greatness of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ. Indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sending His blessing on this blessed and beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and His angel, and in an order and a command for every believer to love him more than he loved himself, and to always send his blessing to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by saying, "Allahumma salli wa sallim ala Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man walah." This is our relation with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We are talking about this because of the event of the Mawlid, as you know, is tomorrow or today, depends on the calendar, in the 12th of the Rabi' al-Awwal. And many people, when it comes to this subject, we have like two great different positions, two substantial, you know, distinct positions. We have an extreme one, from one side they celebrate it and they do all the time of the bid'ah, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companion never did such a thing. But in the other hand also, that there's people, by just mentioning the name of the Mawlid, it's like he's saying something, you know, atrocities, or you're saying an innovation, or you're talking about something so strange that it's haram even to mention it. We don't want to be in either of the extreme, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's teaching us the moderation. He's teaching us how to be in the middle way. We cannot say that the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, something that we need to neglect, something that we need to really ignore because it's a bid'ah even to mention it. That's not right. But in the same time, we will not make the Mawlid, as some of the sects they do it and they glorify it, is like the happening of the whole creation. Why? Because some of them, they're saying that this creation was created because of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and all the soul are being extracted from the light of the soul of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Those are a hadith that are being forged and being saying by people who glorify or over exaggerate the praising of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, do not over exaggerate me. La atatruni kama atrat al-Nasara al-Masih ibn Maryam. Do not over exaggerate me like the Christian did with Isa ibn Maryam alayhi salam. This, ya akhwan, when we took this mas'ala, this issue, we don't want in a way to neglect our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by thinking, by mentioning this Mawlid is bid'ah. Just mentioning his birth, alayhi salatu wasalam. But in the same time, we need to act in the way as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam taught us. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam taught us. It's a great event in the whole universe. Why? Because, as we mentioned before, there is a difference between the decree of Allah, the Amr, and the creation. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decree and will for this universe, for this earth, for this humankind to receive a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is a will that we do not know when it's going to happen. But the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is like the witnessing of the creation, of the coming of this rahmah, and is given the sign of the message. It's something that is there. It's something that you tangible. It's something that is real, that been already created. Therefore, when we're talking about the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is the birth of the coming of the rahmah. Is not the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself in the mercy of Allah? وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. And this is, in this regard, when we think of this, we should not in any way to be rigid in the way how to think about the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yes, we do not celebrate it. Why? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companion, Ridwanullah ta'ala alayhim, that he didn't do such a thing. And we do not celebrate it like some people they do. It's like they make it the center of the whole celebration. It's like nothing, even too much, Eid al-Adha or Eid al-Fitr. That's not right. But also it's not right also to neglect it, to ignore it, to not even think about it. We are talking about al-Rahmatul Muhdad, the given and the gifted rahmah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But someone will ask a question just to take the love that we are required to have. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that our iman is not complete. Actually, our iman is not accepted if we do not love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than we do love ourselves. And someone, he'll ask a question, especially in the society of today, and in the way that people, they think, everyone thinking like about individualism, he can do it himself, he can control everything. Why he has to love a person that he didn't know more than he does for himself?
And this is a question it's allowed to ask in the Sharia, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even in the, He mentioned us when He created Adam, and before He created Adam, He mentioned to the angel that I'm going to create the vicegerent of the earth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed the angel by His will and great rahmah to ask him, why are you doing such a thing when we are worshipping you and we are submitting to you and making tasbih to you, Ya Allah? So the angel, they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the decree that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already did. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He didn't tell them why you asking me. He said, Inni a'lamu ma la ta'lamun, I know what you do not know. So the concern of the angel alayhim as-salam, it was a concern in the favor and the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And someone, he had the right to ask, why should I love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more than do love myself? And this has helped us to really to find the element for everyone who has doubt about that, because it's such a thing that without it our iman is not complete. Without it we will not be on the right path, because the only way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is through His guidance, is through His conduct, is through the love that would be our, the power, or the driving power toward the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, in the hadith al-sahih, being frank, he said, Ya Rasulullah, he was, the Prophet was holding his hand in this hadith, and he said, Ya Rasulullah, I love you more than I love everything else, except myself, which is reality, thinking of himself, such a thing that he will not be one of the hypocrites. But when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, no, you cannot do that, you're not a complete believer till you love me more than you do, you love yourself. And then Umar realizing that is a requirement of the belief, then he said, Ya Rasulullah, then I love you more than everything else. He told them, now Ya Umar. This now Ya Umar is for every one of us. But when someone thinks about himself, he's like being distant from a time far from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how can he love him more than he loves himself? It is a reality, because the only thing that makes someone to be following someone in a very spontaneous way, in a very dedicated way, in a very devoted way, in a way that he will hasten, he run to it, is that really power, that really strength that he need to have, is the love. The love is such power that makes someone to be fully dedicated. When someone loves a person, he will follow him and he will obey him. It's a natural thing in the structure of human being. And the scholar, rahimahumullah ta'ala, always they give us, it's really awkward example, but it's an example that is a reality. When you look at the legacy of the Arab poetry, they always look back at Qais ibn al-Mulawah, known by Majnun Layla, the crazy one, the crazy of Layla. He was fond with this lady named Layla, to the point that he doesn't know anything except her. But the Rahimahullah, our scholar, they mentioned the name, this example in the poetry, the Arabic poetry, by Qais ibn al-Mulawah, just to show the effect of the law on the behavior of the person, on the obedience of the person. When he being asked him, Qais, he told them, from where you come from? He said, I'm coming from Layla. Where are you going? He said, I'm going to Layla. When he was in the Hajj, and he was praying Salat al-Asr, he did more than 8 rak'ah. His father stopped him. He told him, what are you doing? People that start praying and still keep praying. He said, when I remember Layla, I don't know if I prayed 4 or 8. And when he was to repent to Allah sincerely, he said, Ya Allah, I want to repent from everything except from what have my relation or my thinking of Layla, because my heart to repent with is not with me, is in the imprisoned by Layla. This is things, just to show the scholar, they give it as a witness, as evidence of the impact and the effect of the law on the human being nature. In the human being nature, the love will be the really strong, powerful, driving motion for someone to obey. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful, make the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the love of the ubudiyyah, the love of the servitude, the love of the creator, the love of the orientation, the love of the core of our existence. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his love to be behind or below the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of the love who drive us, and with the love who give us the power and the strength and the strength to be on the path traveling to Allah. Because the only path who take us to Allah is the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How can someone will be competing, racing, hastening with kindness, with love, with shawl, to go to Allah if he doesn't love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. If not, he will get another route that will be dictated by his own means, and then he will be far from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam loved every one of us more than we do love ourselves. Because if you love yourself, yourself is going to dictate on you a way that will not be taking you to the pleasure of Allah. But if you love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam more than you do love yourself, because he only concerned about you, therefore you'll find yourself in the way of the ittiba', in the right way of the following of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you find yourself in the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the companions, they were sitting together and they've been asking, what is the ayah that it has the most hope in the ayah of the Quran? Some of the companions, they said, the ayah in Surah Az-Zumar is an amazing ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, Ya ayyuha alladhina qul ya ibadi alladhina asrafu ala anfusihim la taqnatu min rahmatillah. Inna Allah yaghfiru dhunuba jami'an. Inna huwa al-ghafurur rahim. He say, oh my servant who really went astray, those who make a lot of waste on themselves by doing a lot of sins, do not despair from the hope of Allah. Indeed, Allah forgive all sins. This is the ayah that it has most hopeful ayah is in the Quran. Some of the companions, they said, no, there is another ayah. What is this ayah? They said in Surah Al-Duha. In the Surah Al-Duha talking about the Prophet, he said, yes, indeed. What is the specific ayah? The specific ayah, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet, وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْتِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. And Allah will give you till you will be well pleased. Allah will give you whatever you ask till you will be well pleased. And the companion who is reciting this ayah, قَالَ وَلَا يَرْضَى النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ حَتَّى تَدْخُلَ أُمَّتَهُ الْجَنَّةِ. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will not well please it till his all ummah enter paradise. This is the most hopeful ayah in the Quran. But someone will ask, this is really a reality. It's something that we are built in us. The love would motivate you to be an obedient and really racing and competing in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thinking of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he's making dua for you, that he's sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most kind and merciful for all of us. And he's the one, he will be in the day of judgment waiting for us and making, Ya Allah, sallam, sallam, ummati, ummati. When all the other prophets, they talking about themselves, making dua for themselves. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he reserved the dua that he has, exclusive dua, for his ummah in the day of judgment. That's the type of the relation that we need to have of the, with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But someone will ask, okay, I understand, I love him more than I do, I love myself, and this is a reality, this is a nature. How can I get to the pleasure of Allah if I will not get through this path? But how about the other loves? The loves of the children, the loves of the family, the loves of the spouses, the loves of the money, the loves of the business, the loves of the houses. This is, will not contradict that. Actually, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he tell you to do such a thing. He telling us to be the best for our spouses. He telling us to be like very close and shower our children with rahmah. Look his relation with Al-Hassan al-Hussein. Look his relation with his wife. Look at his preferred wife, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. All this is was the law. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in hadith narrated by Al-Bayhaqi and other muhaddithin, they said, four things are signs of happiness. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this is telling us in the hadith. He said, the right spouse is one of the signs of happiness. He said, the righteous neighbor is one of the signs of the happiness. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-markabu al-tahani'u wal-maskanu al-wasa. The wide dwelling, the wide house, and also the comfortable way, means of transportation. Why? Because when you have all this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even though this is from the dunya, but he says, signs of happiness to have you the serenity and the peace of mind to come to Allah willingly and to worship. And the other side, he said, and the signs of unhappiness or misery, to have the opposite of this. An evil or unrighteous or no righteous, someone's spouse or a bad neighbor or a house that someone cannot feel himself and he doesn't have the space with him and his children. And all of that, this is what the Prophet ﷺ told us. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put us like a structure that the believer have to have the priority in it. You have the love of Allah, and then you have the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Under this structure comes all the love that we have a natural attraction to it. قل إن كان آباؤكم وأبناؤكم وإخوانكم وأزواجكم وعشيرتكم وأموال اقترفتموها وتجارة تخشون كسادها ومساكن ترضونها أحب إليكم. So the fact in this ayah, your father, your children, your spouses, your extended family, the money that you are saving, the business that you have, the houses that you love, all of that, they're okay. It's good to love them. It's natural to desire them. But they should be under, within the structure, under the love of Allah and His Messenger, and striving in the sake of Allah. Therefore, the love of the Prophet ﷺ, to love him more than you do love yourself, it doesn't conflict with the way of the life, doesn't conflict with you building life, doesn't conflict with the tayyibat that Allah created for us. Now the question, how someone must love the Prophet ﷺ, this is the most important question. If you understand that loving the Prophet ﷺ more than you do yourself, love yourself, is not going to prevent you from living your life, from having a joyful life, from seeking the happiness of life, from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you as halal. Now the next question is like someone, how someone should love the Prophet ﷺ. In this occasion that we are knowing the greatness of the Prophet ﷺ, for us to remember him more and to do more salat on the Prophet. Because reminding you, one of the companions entered and found the Prophet ﷺ in a very radiant face, a glowing face, smiling. Told him, what happened, Ya Rasulullah? He said, Jibreel alayhi salam just visited me and he told me, Ya Rasulullah, whoever from your ummah will send a blessing on you one time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send it 10 times. Man salla alayya marra sallallahu alayhi ashra. So this is our relation with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then when you say, how should we love then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? There is two ways to love the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A way that takes someone deviated from the path, and a way that makes someone really be on the path. The objective of loving the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to get closer to Allah. The objective of loving the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is to implement the legacy of his teaching, is to follow his sunnah. The objective of loving the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you see all the heaven and the earth as standing by way of Allah, as standing by la ilaha illallah, as standing by the servitude to Allah. Therefore, every believer, his love to Allah and his messenger must help him to contribute in the achievement of the well-being everywhere. And this is a natural way, this is the mission of Islam. But if someone will only target in the love of the Prophet ﷺ the person without considering his message, that's where someone is going to deviate. And that's the people who celebrate the Mawlid by the way of innovation, by way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala nor his Prophet ﷺ mentioned, that's the real deviation. So if someone only loves the person, loving the person, it becomes a way of individualism. What that mean by individualism? Someone here looking at the Prophet as the complete human being who achieved all the great norms of virtues. And when he wants to copy him, he wants to get himself be also source of wisdom. And by thinking that being a source of wisdom, he will come to a point, subhanAllah, to think that he can advance the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's how some of them, they came to the point that they talked about the unity with God. The unity with God. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. That's what they call mysticism, is the unity with God by way of worship and getting the example of the Prophet ﷺ as the complete man. This is a full deviation. But the true believer, when he loved the Prophet ﷺ, he loved the Prophet ﷺ based on his achievement in the way of the conduct, in the way of ubudiyya, in the way of the behavior. Look what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us to make us reflect. He said subhanahu wa ta'ala about if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he will change anything of the book, he will be considered as free of any sin? No. وَإِنْ كَادُوا لَيَفْتِنُونَكَ عَنَّ الَّذِي أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ لِتَفْتَرِيَ عَلَيْنَا غَيْرَهُ وَإِذًا لَاتَّخَذُوكَ خَلِيلًا. They were trying to just for you, pushing you to change some of our words. If you do so, they will be, you'll be their very close friend. وَلَوْلَا أَن ثَبَّتْنَاكَ لَقَدْ كِدْتَ تَرْكَنُوا إِلَيْهِمْ شَيْئًا قَلِيلًا. If and it wasn't the rahmah of Allah to hold you firm, you might have inclined to them a little bit. But if you have done that, إِذَا لَأَذَقْنَاكَ ضَعْفَ الْحَيَاةِ وَضَعْفَ الْمَمَاتِ. If you have done that, we'll have taste you the double punishment in this life and in the hereafter. So look, the greatness of the Prophet ﷺ in his worship to Allah, the greatness of the Prophet ﷺ in the way that Isa called him Ahmad, he's the best worshipper, that would mean Ahmad, he's the one, the best who sent thanks to Allah. The greatness of the Prophet ﷺ in his worship, in his conduct, in his behavior, in his righteousness. That's our way how to get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not the person without the message, it's the person with the message. That's the Prophet that we love. That's the Prophet that we are obligated to love more than ourselves. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. After the Prophet ﷺ passed away, he came to the member of the Prophet ﷺ, and he was given his khutbah. This is the feeling that someone needs to have to the Prophet. The Prophet, within the servitude, we want to copy the Prophet ﷺ in his humbleness, in his righteousness, in his actions, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his very well balanced between all the center of his feeling, the center of his desire, the center of his action with people. This is our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's what we need to love, because that it has the fruit for us to be truthful in the way of Allah, to be truthful in our pace or our steps toward Allah. Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, the love he has to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was saying the ayat, but when he came, he wanted to narrate the hadith of the Prophet, he could not. يقول قال النبي and he stops. قال النبي and he stops. He cannot. That's the love of the messenger, of the Prophet, the great man that they knew, and the great man that we love, the true servant of Allah. The greatest compliment when you say the Prophet is Abdullah. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called him, the perfect servant in the field of the servitude. Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he left the Medina after the death of the Prophet. And he came back to visit the Medina from Ash-Sham. And they asked him to make the adhan. And when Bilal said Allahu Akbar, the whole Medina was quiet. All of them thinking of the Prophet. But Bilal, when he came to Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, he could not say it. Because it's very hard to say it in the masjid of the Prophet, in the absence of the Prophet. And every time he say, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, he will fall in tears. That day the whole Medina was crying because of the love that they have to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the narration, Anas ibn Malik, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was so sad. He told him, why you are sad? Anas ibn Malik, who served the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for 10 years, he said, Ya Rasulullah, I really get comforted when I see you. When away from you, I will be thinking of you. But when I see you, I feel so happy. Now I'm thinking, Ya Rasulullah, if Allah embraced me in His Rahmah in the Day of Judgment, I may not be with you, because you are a prophet, you're going to be with the Prophet, and me, I'm a servant. And he was so sad. And the Prophet ﷺ could not answer him, because he's a Sadiq al-Masduq. He doesn't speak out of his whims. He would not tell him, no, don't worry. He didn't say anything. But at that moment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us the glad tidings. Send us the great news. How can we be with the Prophet ﷺ? How can we be in the companionship of the Prophet? How can we be close to the Prophet? How can we hold his hand? Because we didn't see him in this dunya. We only loved him, and sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we believe in him without seeing him. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that you are his brother and your sister, because we believed in him without seeing him. But we want to see him. We want to hold him. We want to hug him. How can we do that? What should we do today? What type of love that we need to express toward the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? That was a concern of Anas ibn Malik. And in another riwayah of one of the Ansar, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the way how to be with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. قال وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَأُولَئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ. Whoever who obey Allah and His Messenger, obedience, though they will be with those that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestow on them His gifts and blessing, the prophets, as-siddiqeen, the truthful, as-shuhada, the martyrs, as-salihin, the true believer, righteous. وَحَسُنَ إِلَىٰ أُولَٰئِكَ رَفِيقًا. What excellence of company they will have. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make give us the ta'a of Allah and His Messenger, and to make him give us and grant us the companionship with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. اللهم تقبل دعاءنا يا أرحم الراحمين. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروا الغفور الرحيم. بسم الله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على النبي المصطفى. أما بعد, in this occasion, Ikhwani, as we said,
we should not be rigid in mentioning the greatness of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and this occasion of his birth, which is witnessing for the whole creation the coming of the rahmah of Allah. The whole world was suffocating from darkness, from oppression, from injustice, and the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which was the realization in effective coming, in reality, the coming of the rahmah of Allah, the coming of the message of Allah that is going to change the world. It is that coming that it changed the world to be all together today, celebrating and thinking of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, praising of Allah, and send our blessing to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But it's not the end, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to his companion, I will be the one waiting for you by al-hawd, wa ana faratukum yawm al-qiyamati ala al-hawd. Our meeting with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going to be there. When you're going to be resurrected, it's going to be a land you might not anyone. You might see your father, you don't want to see him because he might ask you for your deeds. You might see your mother that you want to run away because you have some deeds, you want to keep them. Because you'll be ashamed if your mother will ask you to give her, said, son, I'll bury you 9 months and I did this for you. Can you give me today one hasana? You're going to say, mother, I need it today for myself. So you see your mother, you run. The only one that you see, you run for is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When are you going to find him in the hawd? Therefore, you're going to be asking the angel, where's the hawd of the Prophet? Where's the hawd of the Prophet? And you will be coming and when he will see you and he will open his hand to welcome you. أَنَا فَرَتُكُمْ I'm going to be waiting for you by al-hawd. What do you need then? You need the identity. What is your identity? It's the light. How can you have the light? The light, you only can have it by the obedience of Allah and His Messenger. The only way, by obedience, by action, by righteousness, by prayer, by helping, by good conduct, by good behavior. That's how can you have the light. And then when you come and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help you and give you the rahmah to be with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you'll be marching together toward the Jannah. يَوْمَ لَا يُخْزِي اللَّهُ النَّبِيَّ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَهُ نورهم يسعى بين أيديهم وبأيمانهم يقولون ربنا أتمم لنا نورنا واغفر لنا إنك على كل شيء قدير. The day Allah will not disgrace the Prophet, and you believer inshallah, you will be marching with the Prophet and your lights are going forth and around you, and all of them, all of you, you'll be saying, O Allah, complete our light. O Allah, forgive our sins. You have the power over all things. Allahumma atmim lana nurana واغفر لنا ذنوبنا إنك أنت الغفور الرحيم. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. اللهم صل وسلم على أشرف المرسلين، سيد المرسلين، خاتم النبيين. اللهم صل عليه صلاة دائمة لا تنفد ولا تبيد، برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اذكروا الله يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه يزدكم، ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقم الصلاة يرحمكم الله.